Welcome to Balanced Life with Debbie Carlin Boyle, conversations connecting to a healthier you, the show that gives you all the latest and greatest health and wellness information to inspire you to live a life of balance and joy. Debbie Carlin Boyle is a health and nutrition coach, personal trainer, and fitness instructor who helps her clients live in balance with everything that feeds us in addition to the food on our plate. Please welcome your host, Debbie Carlin Boyle.
Hi. Welcome, everybody. Welcome to this beautiful, not rainy Tuesday afternoon. We're so glad to have a beautiful day. We've had a lot of rain here in Southern California. Welcome to Balanced Life with me, Debbie Carlin Boyle. We are conversations that connect to a healthier you, and we hope, I hope, that we are doing that for you. So, as you listen today, I have a great guest and a great subject, and we're talking about living in alignment with your heart. So, what exactly does that mean? So, on my show today, we're going to discuss how living from the heart can bring you better health, joy, and success, just to name a few. And my guest, Lisa Brisse, is going to share how and why the heart is so powerful. Lisa is an exercise physiologist, heart coach, author, inspirational speaker, spinning instructor, and founder of State of the Heart Fitness, where she trains for the heart, mind, body, and the soul. Her 26-year career has been dedicated to helping people live their best life through movement, mindfulness, and meditation by the way of the heart. In addition to her one-on-one training and coaching, Lisa also leads retreats, adventure travel, and teaches inspiring spinning classes. And to discuss the shift from head to heart, please welcome my guest today, Lisa Brisse.
Well, thank you.
Applause.
Thank you. So excited
welcome,
to be
Lisa.
Here. Thank you, Debbie.
Before we get into it, I want to remind the audience that we're an interactive show and we'd love to have them become part of the conversation. So if you call us at 323-284-7826, you'll be live on the air. You can talk to Lisa and myself. If you don't want to do that, we're streaming live on the Balanced Life Facebook page. You can leave a comment before, during, or after the show. So there you have it. Welcome,
Yay.
Lisa.
Thank you. So nice to be here.
Thank you for coming.
Yeah,
I know we're out in
you.
Beautiful downtown Burbank. Not easy when you live in beautiful Santa Monica. So
it's
thank
nice
you.
To get out of the hood a little
yeah,
bit and
yeah.
come to another part of the
yes.
the city.
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
We are spread out, but the city in itself mm-hmm. has a lot to offer.
Sure does.
So before we go into alignment and heart space and mm-hmm. all of that, I would like to talk a little bit about your background. We'll briefly hit on how you got to where you sit today, but I would like to go to where you had that moment mm-hmm. of when you knew that the lifestyle that you were teaching and leading as an exercise physiologist mm-hmm. was actually changing people's lives, and how you wanted to put all those things together, mind, body, soul, and heart.
Well, it definitely has been an evolution of my entire journey in my life. For myself, when I was 20 years old, I was grew up in Minnesota. And 2 years after high school, I had kind of fallen into a depression and struggled with that, which was not normal for me. I was always a natural, joyful, buoyant person.
What do you think it was?
Well, this is what got to it.
Okay.
There was, in high school, I was very social. I was in sports. And when I was going on to college, I ended up staying at home and commuting to college at St. Cloud State University because I had horses. We lived on the lake. I wasn't ready to leave home. And that was all wonderful, except something happened that I fell into this deep depression where I was literally crying every night. My mom would just sit there and kind of hold me. And long story short, what was going on now looking back, my heart was calling me to California when I was 16.
There was a pull.
There was a pull
to come this way.
That I was fighting. My heart was saying, you need to go. And my mind, which our head, gets in the way and says, that's not logical. You don't know anybody there. You know, you're going by yourself. So I was fighting that within myself. And it got to the point where I got scared that if I stayed
here,
I didn't know what I was what my life was going to be for myself. And I knew I had to take a risk and follow my heart and trust in it, that it was taking me away from everything that I loved and knew. But I had to trust that it was taking me to a place that I needed to go. And driving to California by myself, well, actually I had a friend who drove with me, but tears streaming down my face of total fear, feeling like I was driving into the abyss, like not knowing why I was being called to California. But at the same time, tears of exhilaration of, oh, my God, I have the courage to do this. And you know, my life is a canvas and I can paint it to whatever it is and whatever I dream. And literally, it was like when I crossed the border of California, it was literally like my depression just
lifted,
dissipated.
And along with the sunshine.
Yes, the sun came out. And what it showed me was that when we are fighting, you know, what our mm-hmm. heart is telling us, and we're going with what our head is telling us, the logic and all of this. If we're going out of alignment of what our heart is calling, our heart and soul is calling us to do, it takes us down a dark road.
Very much so.
And that affects our health, our joy, our peace, our whole life. Yeah. And so
everything. We can't be successful within ourselves or even for anybody else or anything else when we're out of alignment.
Yeah.
So, go ahead. Were you already an exercise physiologist?
No.
So you did that. And then I
knew I wanted to study, you know, I was an athlete in school and I wanted to teach exercise and health because it was such a positive influence on my life. Mm-hmm. And so I ended up getting my degree in sports medicine at Pepperdine. Again, I didn't even know I was going to end up at Pepperdine. That began the magic of following my heart.
What a beautiful location.
Oh, my gosh. I didn't even know of Pepperdine until I moved out here and sat up on the mountain. It was like, oh, my gosh. You know. So, and one thing just led to another. Like, keep opening your heart. Keep trusting. Keep, you know, leaning into it. And magical things have happened. Long story short, I ended up as an exercise physiologist working with people with heart disease, diabetes, various kinds of health issues, as well as young fit people as well. But what I have found, and in 2001 when I started State of the Heart Fitness, mm-hmm. was that we have to live in alignment with our heart if we want our health, if we want our peace, if we want joy, if we want connection to everything, to everyone.
It's so true. It makes so much sense. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's no arguing that we have this push-pull thing that happens to us, and that we have this little, you know, it is the three principles that I was talking with mm-hmm. you about earlier, the power of the mind, mm-hmm. your thought and your consciousness, mm-hmm. how the power, we have the ability mm-hmm. to turn off that little annoying thing that says to us, no, you can't.
Yes.
You're not good enough.
Yes.
You're not going to be successful. You're not, you know, it's that little devil on the shoulder. We can choose to close the door and not let that devil in.
Yes.
But it's so much easier to do it. And it takes a lot, you know, it takes a lot of releasing and and working. What kinds of things have you done? Did you have to continue to do to make sure that you followed your heart?
Well, and that voice that you're talking, I have a name for it. I call it the S voice, which is the saboteur voice. Is the saboteur voice is that part of ourselves that is that, you know, that what we've been taught to believe that, no, you don't deserve that, or that dreams aren't for you, they're for other people, or whatever it is. And so, you know, I've always been on the spiritual journey. It's just been a part of my being ever since I was a kid. I was always, you know, interested in life. And if we're on this planet, I mean, there's got to be a bigger reason other than just to go to work and pay bills and do that. And so on my spiritual journey, you know, that's also called the ego voice, the part of ourselves that's disconnected from the bigger picture and that doesn't believe in the bigger picture, where the heart is tapped into that bigger picture. So it's a conscious awareness, mindfulness, as we call it, being mm-hmm. mindful of the thoughts and the voices in our head, you know, that saboteur voice that is saying, that's beating ourselves up, that's the critic, the judgment that we do of ourselves that beats us down.
I heard it said, I've heard this saying before, that we have like a zoo in our head.
The monkey brain?
Yeah. Well, that there's a lot of animals that have to coincide with each other harmoniously in order for us to be able to move forward with our lives in a positive way.
Yes.
But if all those animals are at war, all those little creatures in our head, like you said, are at war with each other, then we can't open up ourselves to be successful because we're allowing them to battle and defeat us.
Exactly.
Know? And so I've heard it put different ways.
Yes.
The saboteur, I haven't heard before.
Yes.
I always think of the little devil. I always think of that little voice, that little devil, you know, just because I put a visual to it, you know.
Yeah.
And it's true for so many people. And it takes you down a negative road.
Yeah.
It takes you down to depression.
Yes.
Because you know there's something better.
Yes.
There's, you know that you can do it.
Yes.
But you feel defeated before you even try.
Yes.
And I see when people don't have good self-care, it's easier to keep going negative than it is to find the strength for the positive.
Yes.
You know, because there is that snowball effect to self-care.
Yes.
That allows you to keep going forward.
Yes.
So that's how do you work with people to transition from the head to the heart?
Well, first of all, we identify what is the difference between the head is, you know, like I say, the monkey brain or all that noise that's in our head that makes us stressed, that makes us frantic, whatever it is that makes us doubt or fear. Recognize that, because awareness is the key to everything. And then recognize what it means to be in the heart. And some of the things that I do, of course, the breath is the key to centering into the heart.
Without it, we can't live.
Live. I mean,
it's called the art of living.
Yes.
There's a whole meditation practice called the art of living.
Yes.
It's really known as the art of breathing.
Yes, exactly.
It's how you live.
The breath is the key. I mean, we can go a few weeks without food. We can go a few days without water. We could only go a few minutes without breathing. So it's obviously it's pretty important. So just breathing, I teach people about breathing, the importance of breathing and diaphragmatic breathing, breathing in through the nose, deep into the lungs, deep into the abdomen, and as opposed to short, shallow breaths through the mouth, which short, shallow breaths actually stimulate the stress response of the nervous system, the fight or flight response, where the deep diaphragmatic breathing actually switches to the parasympathetic part of the nervous system, which is the relaxation response. And when our breath can, within seconds, by just tuning in and breathing those deep breaths, we can get into the heart center. We can feel that calm, that peace, which is our truest state of being. I always say it's our truest state of being.
It's where we're meant to be. It's our surrounding. It's everything that surrounds us that puts us into, triggers our stress hormone, our cortisol levels change.
It's like I have a hurricane. The heart is the eye of the hurricane. It's the inner calm while the storm of the world spins around us. And when we're in our head, that's usually where we are. We're in the storm. But we can, with the breath, immediately center into the heart and find that calm in any moment. I just did a yoga class in Mexico. I was visiting my family there. And this woman said, and I had never heard it like this, but I loved it. She said, "This is the most powerful antidepressant there is.
Your nose. Being able to breathe,
to breathe
it in."
Yes.
And that's probably why all yoga practices, no matter what the yoga practice is, incorporates breath.
Yes.
And I tell you, know, and you, we both know as personal trainers, the breath is very vital to how you work out and how we have muscle control that way.
Yes.
It's got everything to do with you know, we use it in spin class big time.
Absolutely.
I had Jeff Grossman was on a couple of weeks ago, and he does the slow motion strength training.
Yeah.
And it's all about the breath, which is kind of counterintuitive to the way most bodybuilders breathe.
Yeah.
But it's very functional, and it's about gaining strength through the breath and the movement.
Absolutely. I always say in my classes, your breath is your power. Breathe into it and really take it in, because that's where we can tap into our inner strength and our inner power that we can't when we're not grounded.
Yeah. When we're mindless about going about our day-by-day business. And that's why meditation is so important too, I think.
Yes, yes.
Because it makes us stop.
Stop and pause. And there's a power in the pause. It brings us into the present moment. And this is where we have all the power that we need.
Yeah.
It's right here, right now. As soon as we let our mind go off into the future and start worrying about things that may never happen, or we dwell in the past of I should have done this differently or whatever, we go into self-judgment, we've immediately taken ourselves out of the only moment that we can change. And that's the moment right here, right now, the present.
Mm-hmm.
And so why would we want to let all of that go when we can bring it right here, right now.
And when it's a much more pleasant place to be.
Yes.
Than thinking about, oh, how's that going to turn out? Or how am I going to handle this person? And how am I going to get all this done? And, you know, it just, we live in that. We live in that. And, you know, societal pressures pull that upon us.
Yes.
But I think there is a universal consciousness, sort of an awakening of people. There's more people like us in the world that are helping people find their center and find their heart space and get out of their head. Mm-hmm. And people like, you know, Del, my co-host for so many years, being in the three principles practice now, that is getting you to slow down and pay attention that your thoughts are, you know, we have so many of them. They're fleeting and you can choose which ones to hold on to and which ones are going to destroy you or which ones can actually uplift you.
Well, we want to be a conscious creator. And in every moment, I always say this to my clients, we are making choices, whether we're aware of those choices, whether they're conscious or unconscious. Ideally, when they're conscious, we get to the power to choose, okay, is this choice going to uplift me? Is this going to enhance my health and well-being? Or is it going to take me down lower? Is it going to take me away from where I want to be? So the power of being conscious of our choices, which requires us to be present, is that we can make that decision of, wow, okay, I know making this choice is going to pull me down, but this choice is going to take me closer to my heart, to where I want to be in my life. So
That's lovely. I think that's great. We're a society
compulsiveness. Yes.
Yeah. Being impulsive too. Yeah. And habitual as well.
Oh yes.
And the thing about
automatic.
And that's the thing about, I think, meditation.
Yes.
And this thing, you can change your habit.
Absolutely.
Once you just settle in, it's the same thing with diet and exercise.
Absolutely.
If you bring that into your life.
Yep.
It can become part of your routine and part of who you are. It doesn't mean because you grew up eating fried food and processed food that you can't change that habit.
No.
People don't seem to understand that. They'll use every excuse. Yes, it's easier to not change habits sometimes, and it's frightening to take the step.
And what I say to people is, yes, we can do everything if we take it to the moment, each moment. Like, I tell my clients, don't think about what you're going to do tomorrow. Think about what you can do. What's one thing you can do today that steps you into the direction you want to go? Even if it's just one small thing. And then next, tomorrow, what's one small thing I can step into the place I want to be, into my heart space?
Right.
It's just one, you know, in AA programs, everything, it's one
step
at a time. One day at a time.
Yeah.
And we can do anything if it's just small little baby steps.
Right.
And we just are consistent and frequent with it.
You know,
the body.
I do that with my clients.
Yeah.
I mean, that's what coaching really is about. We're the cheerleaders.
Yes.
You have, my clients have within them, like, for instance, I'll give you an example. I was, I've been working with a client now for almost a year.
Yeah.
She was overweight. She was going through a tough time, three grown kids, tough time with her relationship was ending with her husband. And she was depressed.
Yeah.
And her whole life, she wasn't eating right. She never exercised.
Right.
So I realized if I start bombarding her with exercise and self-care antidotes and a new diet, she would reject it all.
Yep.
It would be too sudden. And
yep.
So we gradually, she came to me 2 to 3 days a week.
Yeah.
We did the exercise part of it.
Yeah.
She started to see a change. She started to feel better. Then she started asking me about the diet.
Yep.
Now we're at it. You know, I started talking to her. We've had health coaching sessions. And I said, when you're ready.
Yeah.
When you're ready. She started making the small diet changes.
Yeah.
On her own,
yeah.
She started joining things like meditation classes, she's a cake decorating class, things that would, learning to knit and crochet, things that were going to give her joy that she would never have done before,
right.
Are now, it's now her whole self is glowing.
Right.
And yesterday she came to me after almost 1 year and said, I'm ready to start doing the diet changes because I've already been doing it.
Yeah.
Now I want to know what will be right for me. So she had the answers within herself.
That is awesome.
We just need to coach them, you know?
And be the support system
hold
the space for them to find their way. You know, it's not my agenda for them. As you know, it's we just are here to hold a loving and healing space.
That's right.
For them to discover it on their own and in their timing.
That's right. Because oftentimes, you know, being we have an audience because mm-hmm. we teach. And
yeah.
being in front of large groups, and I said this before and I'll say it again because I say it a lot. But I think that locker rooms are a great networking
yeah.
space,
yes.
you know, within, for me, obviously, within the
right.
female realm.
Right.
And I find that I just lost my train of thought where I was going with...
being in the locker room?
Yeah. No, with the networking and... Oh, that people always say, what should I be eating?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Why
yeah.
can't I sleep? Why? They want these hard, fast answers, but it's so individual.
It is.
And we have to open space for each and every one of them to find their answers within them.
Absolutely. And we have to look at the big picture. It's not just this one thing. It's like, you know, a lot of times when people come to me, I go through a thorough, you know, question asking of their whole life, because you got to this point right here, right now, and I want to learn about the path that got you here. Like, one of the questions that I ask people is, you know, what was your experience of PE class in elementary school? And you think that would be kind of a weird question, but everybody's like,
it's telling.
80%, I would say, or even 90 people are like, I hated it. Why are you asking me that? Well, because that's been ingrained in your being, that you associate exercise with a humiliating experience. If you weren't good, like I loved PE. I couldn't wait for PE, but that was my thing. I loved it.
Right.
But how many people didn't love it because they didn't feel good? And the way PE was taught back then, it wasn't in a way that encouraged people. It was like, oh, you're an athlete here, throw the ball to you. So I get it. And I want people to recognize that exercise and movement is a beautiful thing, and I want it to be a positive experience that uplifts them
right.
instead of makes them feel like crap. There's enough of that. You know?
Exactly. Yeah. It makes them feel defeated.
Yes.
Because feeling defeated in anything puts you don't lean into anything there.
No.
You run the other way.
Absolutely.
You know? We are running out of time because it just goes by so fast. So what I want to do is talk a little bit about, I mean, we've talked about head and heart and how to get from your head to your heart, which I encourage you to go to Lisa's website and try to talk to Lisa or continue this conversation with us online. But I want to get to you're hosting a couple of retreats where people can actually work with you from wherever they're at. They can come and be with you.
Yeah.
Let's talk about that. And you've also written a new book. So I want to talk about that before we end.
Yes. Well, real quickly this weekend, I am co-hosting a weekend rejuvenation retreat in Santa Barbara with Vanessa Kudrat-Weinberg. And so it's Friday afternoon through Sunday morning. And it's just going to be in El Capitan Canyon, just north of Santa Barbara, right there on the beach.
Beautiful.
It's gorgeous.
Beautiful location.
Little
it's going to be a warm weekend this
Yes, it is.
Too.
And the flowers are out and it's green. And so it will be, you know, some hiking, some meditation, some yoga, some water aerobics, community meals together around the campfire. It's just going to be lovely. We did it last year and it was wonderful. So I'm very excited about that. So
they can access that on your website.
Yes.
What's
yes.
your website, Lisa?
stateoftheheartfitness.com.
Yeah.
Yes.
Good.
Thank
and
you.
It's up on the screen too if you're watching us.
Yeah. And then in June, if anybody's extra ambitious, and I am taking a small group to Peru for 10 days, June 6th through the 16th. And 5 days of that, we are going to be exploring around Cusco and the Sacred Valley and the Peruvian culture, of course, and the Incas.
Wow.
And then we're going to do 5 days of trekking in the Andes to Machu Picchu. And in 2010, I took a group of seven. And it was, well, in 2009, I went for my 40th birthday with some friends. And then when I came back, I had a bunch of people say, would you would you train us to do this? So we did it in 2010. It was amazing. And now I'm going to revisit and go back. And I've got four people, but there's two more spots available. So if anybody has any questions or, you know,
same thing.
Yes.
Going state of the heart.
Yes. State of the heart.
.com.
So for a heart, mind, body, soul experience and Peru is just magical and mystical and it just gets into your consciousness in the most amazing way.
Wow.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, there's some ways that people can can work with you.
Yes.
And tell us about, and I want to hear, because I haven't, I know you were writing it.
Uh-huh.
And I have to say that Lisa and I've worked for Lisa for the last 3 years, mm-hmm. teaching spinning mm-hmm. at a beautiful hotel on the beach here in Southern California.
Mm-hmm.
They have since done away with their outside program. They're only making that available to
the
guests.
Hotel guests. Yeah.
So we kind of broke off professionally, but we're still friends.
Yes.
And we still help each other out within this field.
Yes.
So I knew you were writing the book, and you've been on the show. We've had equine therapy shows together with Kate Nelligan and Dell.
Yeah.
But tell us about this book real quick.
Well, as you know, my greatest teacher in this life was my horse, Little Miss, mm-hmm. who, God rest her soul, she passed in May of 2017 at the age of 36. And
amazing.
I had her 35 of those 36 years.
Amazing.
And we had a journey together that I'm still feeling how in depth and profound it was. And she still is with me on the other side guiding me. And she's right here. Hi, horse. But I've been a writer ever since I was a kid. And so in the mid-90s, when I realized that she was teaching me things, I started making notes. And what it's evolved to is a trilogy, because she lived so darn long. And the first book is coming out this year called The Ride of Our Life, Life Lessons Learned from a Magical Horse, Little Miss. So I am so excited to share her and her wisdom and her love and her insights that I've been such a lucky, blessed recipient to receive. And now I want to share them with the world, because it's just, it's stuff that we all need, and it's all of the heart.
Good.
It's all of the heart. So.
And that keeps it forever, ever there, too.
Yes.
I love that.
Yes.
And that's beautiful.
Yeah.
So another thing that you can access coming out this year, 2019.
Yes.
Ah, lovely. Beautiful.
First book of three, so there might be four. Anyway.
Well, I have to say thank you.
Thank you.
And I know we'll continue to do shows together, because we're all growing all the time.
Yes.
And I hope that you got something out of this day. Do go to Lisa's website and stateoftheheart.com. See everything she's about and how you can access Lisa. Or go to our Facebook page, my Facebook page, Balanced Life, and continue the conversation there. Make a comment if there's something you heard today you would like to make a comment about or ask a question. We would love for you to do that. We'll keep the conversation going. And I want to thank you for joining us. And as always, I want you to remember to keep finding ways to go ahead and become a healthier you. Bye, everybody.
Bye. Thank you.